Myopia, also known as nearsightedness, is on the rise, dramatically so in some parts of the world, and especially happening among children. With us now on the causes and the extent to which it's going on here, optometrist Vishakha Thakra, who is owner of Vaughan Vision Center. Hi.
Hi, how are you?
It's really nice to have you here.
Thank you.
So you can tell, I'm a member of this glasses-wearing group.
Welcome to the club.
Yeah, and I've had glasses since I was really young. So to see it on the rise again, as a parent, I'm concerned. So can you help us understand, just give us a definition, what is myopia?
So myopia, the most basic way of describing it is nearsightedness. So that what that means is that people with who are nearsighted, they can't see distance, they can see near very clearly. So if you, for example, take your glasses off, you can see up close quite well. The issue with that definition, though, it's actually changed in the last few years because of the rise of myopia. So now the newer definition actually involves the word disease in the definition, saying that it's an elongation, it's a lengthening of the eyeball, which leads to disease and, you know, refractive error change, which is nearsightedness. So it's completely shifted in the past few years.
Why has it shifted? Why has the definition shifted?
Because myopia is on the rise in huge proportions. So if you look at Asia, for example, China, Singapore, Japan, the percentage of adults with myopia is in excess of 80%. In fact, in some countries, it's over 90%. And in Canada or the United States, the Western world in general, we're not that far behind. I mean, the estimates right now in Canada are around 40% myopia in adults. So the trend right now is completely shifting where children, more and more children are becoming myopic.
Why is that a concern? Because we can wear glasses, we can get contact lenses.
Yeah, so that's really the more benign way of looking at it, right? So for years we thought, okay, well, a child is myopic, we can give them glasses, we can give them contact lenses, they can see. That's great for the Western world. Mm-hmm. The issue, though, is that the more myopic or the more nearsighted a patient becomes, the higher chance there is of disease later on. So what's going on right now, and the big problem, is that younger and younger children are becoming myopic. So it used to be that 8 to 12-year-olds mm-hmm. were nearsighted. Now we've got 5, 6, 7-year-olds becoming nearsighted. And what ends up happening is their eyeball continues to lengthen and the prescription continues to get higher through their teen years, even sometimes into their 20s. What comes with that is diseases like cataracts, myopic maculopathy, which is a type of macular degeneration, mm-hmm. Retinal detachment, glaucoma. So the prevalence of that is increasing as well. And what the fear is that in the 21st century, myopia is going to be leading to the highest cause of sight-threatening or vision-threatening disease.
And as a society, how does that impact us?
In so many ways. I mean, we can break it down from just quality of life, first of all. So people who tend to be highly nearsighted, they are more anxious around their eyes. I mean, they cannot see without their glasses. So, you know, lower myopes, they're usually quite comfortable in their vision. In terms of society, though, when you think about the burden of healthcare and losing eyesight, people who are in that category become very fearful. And if you're thinking, you know, I think the statistic is, in 2050, 30% of patients who are myopic will have some sort of sight-threatening disease, you know, with the older adults. And, I mean, that is a huge problem. It's actually reaching epidemic proportions worldwide.
Epidemic.
Yeah.
I remember when we were younger, my sister wanted to be a pilot, but we found out she had, like, a lazy eye, so she couldn't do it. Mm-hmm. How would that impact certain jobs that we need to get done in our societies?
So it's similar in that sense, where a lazy eye, you know, you have one eye that's weaker. With myopia, there's certain careers such as policing, military, RCMP, where they want vision to be strong without correction, meaning without contact lenses, without glasses. And so I used to work in a refractive surgery center where, like, young people would come in to get surgery in order to have, in order to carry on their careers. And sometimes they'd be denied because they're not good candidates. Mm. So it does impact those types of careers.
Is it genetic? Myopia?
So there are genetic components, absolutely. What we're realizing now is that the lifestyle components have even a heavier weight. So, for example, if you have two parents who are myopic their child has a 3 times higher chance of developing myopia. But you compound that with what we have in our environment right now. So for example, we were meant to be hunters and gatherers. We were meant to be out there looking at distance. And now that's shifted to majority of our day is here.
Oh my gosh, yeah, we're like
all the time, right? And I would argue like teenagers are worse than we are that way, right? They're here all the time. And so you've got this shift where the human race was meant to look far away. Mm-hmm. Now we're looking close. We're also not spending that time outside. So in order to protect children from developing nearsightedness, they need to play. They need to be outside in the sunlight, in the air, you know, that sort of thing. And now their playtime is here, just like you said. Mm-hmm. And so the more near work we do, we're causing that shift where our vision is getting better here and poorer far away.
I want to talk more about solutions in just a little bit, but yeah. You mentioned diseases. Mm-hmm. What diseases are associated with myopia?
So diseases that occur later on as the eyeball, because when you think about it, the eyeball lengthens with myopia. So think about a balloon stretching. Mm-hmm. And so that causes retinal problems because the retina is the back of the eye, so that can stretch, right? And that can cause retinal holes, tears, detachment, which is sight-threatening. Also a type of macular degeneration called myopic maculopathy. Mm-hmm. That increases with every number you go up. So like from a 2 to a 3 and a 3 to a 4, it goes up exponentially. Diseases like cataracts as well.
Well, what are you seeing at your practice? Are you seeing an increase in myopia?
So there's a huge increase in myopia. So what I actually noticed much more is in the last 3 years since the pandemic, there has been a jump. So previously, you know, over the past 10 years, I saw a steady increase of myopia. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden, after the lockdown, kids are coming in, and kids that I never thought would have been myopic before developed myopia. And so kids that I thought would be fine through these years, and my colleagues are talking about the same thing. In fact, there's studies that have shown that the percentage and prevalence of myopia has increased in the last few years.
Well, I was going to ask you, were the lockdowns part of what created this problem?
I believe so.
Yeah.
So again, when you think about the amount of device time and how that's caused behavior change. So there was an immediate behavior change, but look how much kids are using devices now relative to like say 2019.
Oh, trust me, I remember being that parent. My children would never have screens. And then when the lockdowns happened, it's like, here you go.
Yeah, and it was okay. And mm-hmm. it was acceptable in the schools. It was acceptable with parents. And then trying to reverse that, it's mm-hmm. very, very difficult. And that's, as an optometrist, I'm trying to work with parents to reduce that screen time. And even if it's I can't change things, or you know, we as optometrists, we can't change things throughout the day completely, mm-hmm. but like giving breaks, you know, taking your eyes away from the phone, you know, not going from computer to talking to your friends on the phone to looking at Instagram, you know, those are the things that are causing this to get worse and worse, and putting breaks in between is really helpful.
Mm-hmm. Help me understand this, because I think some people might be confused, because when we're reading pretty close, right, to our faces and mm-hmm. magazines. So is being on your computer worse than reading a book? Like how does that, what's the difference?
So we don't know that for sure,
yeah,
right? There's nothing to fully prove that. Mm-hmm. What we do know about devices is they're very addictive, and we tend to just stare. And if you see a child or even an adult looking at a device or a video game, we do this, right? So we're really fixated. Since I really think when it comes to reading in general, reading is great, I mean, in terms of education, but the habits around reading are different than the habits around using devices. And we're thinking that's where the trend is coming.
And then the light from the tablet or phone, right?
Well, the blue light is a little bit different. Mm. So that's different from myopia. The blue light, there is anecdotal evidence that that can cause, you know, changes to the retina, but that's not fully proven. Mm-hmm. More than anything, I find at this point, blue light causes strain. It can cause changes to melatonin release. But it doesn't really, at this point, have an impact on myopia.
You mentioned China earlier. Mm-hmm. How much attention is this issue getting in other countries?
Well, in Asian countries, it's huge. So the government is truly recognizing that myopia is a problem. Think about, you know, the population being 80 to 90-some percent myopic.
So and why is that?
So I think, I mean, not just I, researchers think, that there has been such a shift in focusing on academics. So genetics is part of it, mm-hmm. but you put a child indoors on a regular basis studying and always looking here, you know, that's where that shift's going to occur. So it's a combination between genetics and lifestyle. Mm-hmm. And so, for example, in China, I read an article where there's actually like bars in front of their near work so that they don't come too close. Because there's a difference between reading at this distance and reading at this distance.
Right.
You know what I mean? They're limiting the amount of device time in the classroom to, I think it's like 20 to 30 minutes. And even limiting the amount of device time at home. So kids are being told to use, like, study in different ways, not on the computer. Mm-hmm. And the thing is, I mean, China, it's a communist government. They can impose these kinds of changes. But I think what it shows us is that governments need to eventually take on, like, recognize what is happening, mm-hmm. to make little changes, even if, like, for example, in Canada, if our educators knew more about how to help prevent myopia, I think it could be huge with children.
Because we're moving more to learning online, being part of the curriculum.
Yeah. And the thing is our projected numbers in 2050, we're going to be following China. We're expected to reach that 80% prevalence by 2050. And that's, what, 27 years away?
Yeah. I don't know if you've noticed this. This drives our director crazy. I keep having to do this because I should be wearing progressives, but I'm too vain. So I have to go this.
No one will know if you're wearing them, though.
Do you think there's much awareness about myopia here in Canada?
No, I don't. I think in the past 5 to 6 years with optometrists, you know, we've been doing more and more. In terms of parents, very few parents know about, like, they know that, like, with myopia and nearsightedness, you can go and get glasses and contact lenses. But they don't know the repercussions of myopia, and they don't know that there are things we can do to control myopia and to lower the progression of myopia. And the thing is it's not even just parents. I mean, parents are visiting their pediatricians and GPs, and I think it would be wonderful if they could also be educated that, you know, when a child is nearsighted, there are potential eye diseases that are related to this later on, but the optometrist can actually help reduce that progression, which is, I think, very, very important in this, you know, in this decade.
Well, I have to admit, for me, I just thought if they need glasses, I'll just get them glasses. But there are solutions, so let's talk about them.
Yeah.
Is there anything that can be done to reduce the progression of nearsightedness?
Absolutely. So in Canada, we're very, very fortunate because we are really leading the world in offering patients options for myopia control or devices to slow down the progression. So a couple years ago, right after the pandemic, or right after the lockdown, I should say, glasses were released. And these glasses have specific optics where kids can still see clearly, but the optics change the retinal growth or the eyeball growth, which is huge. It's great for these kids who are 5, 6, 7 years old, just entering into the space or becoming myopic. So that's hugely beneficial. So we can reduce the outcome of the number. In terms of contact lenses, there's contact lenses as well.
I'm a grown-up, and I, for the life of me, I cannot put on contacts. Is getting contacts with a child a good idea?
So, I mean, for medical
purposes...
You have
to clean them and all that?
Yeah, for medical purposes, I've been fitting babies with contact lenses, so that's another story entirely. But, you know, there's even studies that show that 8 to 12-year-olds have the same sort of success as teenagers when it comes to putting on contact lenses. But really, it's when I'm talking about contact lenses with parents, it's very much about the motivation of the child, the cleanliness of the child.
Mm-hmm. And
the comfort of the parents. So you can do it, but the child has to be in the right frame of mind to do it.
So there's dailies for children?
There's dailies. There's lots of them. There's lots of them. And there's also drops mm-hmm. for these types of patients. So we have so many options. And like I said, Canada leads the world in this.
Well, tell me more about some of the treatments and therapies that are available.
Sure. So I mentioned glasses. Mm-hmm. These contact lenses have specific designs as well, where a child can see distance very well, but there is a change in the optics to slow down the progression. So those are soft, often daily wear lenses. They can throw them away every day. Mm-hmm. There is another type of lens called Ortho K, and the Ortho K is an overnight hard lens where it actually changes the surface of the cornea. And by doing that, it projects light a different way into the eye, which also slows down the progression of myopia. Now, the cool thing with those lenses is kids wear them overnight and they can see pretty much perfectly during the day.
I love science.
I know. Isn't that great? And the last type is atropine. Mm. So atropine is a certain drop used for dilation for a century. And now in a diluted form, mm-hmm. you can use it to slow down the progression of myopia.
Are you involved in any studies looking into therapies?
I'm involved in a myopia control study. I'm not allowed to talk about it yet. But I've been doing the therapies for over 10 years.
Okay.
So, and it's something that I've seen great benefit for my patients.
Solutions are great to have, but you know, some of this stuff costs a lot of money. Does OHIP or insurance companies cover the cost of these expenses?
So OHIP will cover an eye exam for a child up until the age of 19. And then in terms of these therapies, you know, the glasses and contact lenses are covered under insurance plans. It just depends what your insurance plan, like some people have $200, some people have $500. It just depends what your plan covers. In terms of the treatment itself, it's considered a therapy. And at this point, I haven't seen any insurance companies covering it. Mm-hmm. I think as knowledge and awareness come about, that is a possibility in the future. But again, like you brought it up, the awareness is not the greatest in, mm-hmm. in Canada.
It's one thing to have a solution, but I know for my kid, even just trying to get him to like clean his ears, he's very sensitive with things.
Yeah.
Many kids might be reluctant to try on contact lens. What can you do to encourage them to wear them?
Well, I mean, firstly, if they're fully reluctant, glasses mm-hmm. are the option. We can go right to glasses.
There's so many cool ones.
There's so many cool ones. And some kids come in and they just get glasses with no prescription in them because they love them so much. When it comes to contact lenses, I think it really comes down to, you know, I often put a lens on the eye when a patient's sitting in my chair. Mm-hmm. If they are fully reluctant, then they're not ready yet. If they allow me to do it, then it's just about a matter of practicing and being in an office that really can teach them how to, you know, take care of it, how to put them in, how to take them out, how to train the parents. And for people that don't have an eye doctor, I mean, if you go to findaneyedoctor.ca, you will be able to find eye doctors within Ontario.
Oh, that's really helpful.
Yes.
What can we do to avoid myopia in the first place? Can we?
Yes. That's the biggest question, actually. So the key is playing outside. The recommendation is that children play outside for 2 hours at least a day. So for younger kids, you know, you have kids. Mm-hmm. Younger kids, it's a lot easier, right? It becomes more difficult as they become teenagers. So before myopia onsets, it is important that they're outside. It's actually very protective. So in terms of initial recommendations, that would be mine.
People point to the effects of social media on our mental health and put pressure on the tech companies to come up with solutions to that problem. Do you think a similar thing might happen with the increase in myopia?
I think there's a possibility. I think, though, that it's first starting with government, and then secondly, you know, with these more devices coming out, pharmaceutical companies and manufacturers are helping educate on this. I think if you get these bigger companies and bigger players involved in terms of awareness, then the tech companies need to jump in as well at mm-hmm. some point. But I think that it all comes from awareness and having that, in a way, bigger money supporting this cause.
Dr. Takara, thank you so much for helping us understand such something that is so complex and something that needs to be talked about right now.
Great.
We appreciate your time.
Thank you for having me.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is made possible through generous philanthropic contributions from viewers like you. Thank you for supporting TVO's journalism.